And we have three speakers today. We have Jessica Watashik with Crow Wing Energize, Todd Holman with the Baxter City Council, and myself with the City of Brainerd Walkable, Bikeable City Committee. And then we also have Todd, who's going to be representing the No Name Bicycle Committee, which some of us are on. So that's been a big part of this effort, too. So we have shared goals. When we got together and meet to talk about this presentation, we talked about the shared goals we have. And basically, the number one is, you know, we want healthy communities for people of all ages to live and grow. And when we think about non-motorized transportation, you know, number one, at least in my book, is commuting, and commuting to work or to church or to schools or whatever. So we have safe routes to school as part of it, as well as workplace wellness. And there's a number of programs for that. And also for recreation, of course, and we want to have safe trails for a lot of family fun, safe and clean trails. So why? So the number one thing that we see in the research is that people who walk or bike to retail establishments, it's not the number one thing, but people who do this spend more time than people who drive to the same places they found. So if they go shopping or go to an event with their bike, they a lot of times will spend more time. A 10-year study found that they found a significant connection between walkability and health. And people who with Alzheimer's and older adults who live in places with higher connectivity performed better on initial cognitive tests and saw fewer declines in attention and verbal memory. I'm having a hard time seeing this. I'll try over here. Oops. So in 2009, CEOs found that for cities found that homes and neighborhoods with good walkability are more valuable than similar homes and neighborhoods where residents have to drive to get to amenities. And I think about that as our one neighborhood grocery store closed in Brainerd this year. And now I'm seeing people walk. They must be going to the Holiday gas station, the kids carrying milk. And I drive down Oak Street, and I see kids carrying milk and cereal sometimes in the morning when I'm coming to work. And now they have to walk much further because that grocery store closed. The National Association of Realtors agree that more walkable neighborhoods add value to a home. And people who live in areas with fewer turns are required to navigate the streets performed worse on cognition tests and were more likely to see attention and verbal memory declines. And conversely, those who lived in places with higher connectivity performed better on cognitive tests and saw fewer attention and memory and verbal declines. So those are some of the reasons. And one thing I just saw today was an email that talked about how people live longer who commute to work either on bicycles. It was a study done in the UK, and they found that people live a lot longer when they're commuting to work on a regular basis. So those are some of the things about why, what brings us to the table. And I'm looking around the room here, and I imagine most of us are here because we have those interests and beliefs. And later on, we're going to have a discussion so that you'll be able to give input to of what's going on in your area. With that, I'm going to turn it over to Jessica Watashik, who's going to talk about the efforts of Crow Wing Energize. And if you want to...
Okay. Well, hi everyone. I am Jessica and I'm with Crow Wing Energized. And if you're familiar with Crow Wing Energized, we are a collaboration between Essentia Health and Crow Wing County. And we have different goal groups that are focused on making our community a better place. So we have goal groups that talk about just workplace wellness and how to make our workplaces more healthy and to encourage employees to be more active and make those healthier choices. We have a committee that we'll talk about here about that's just focused on community healthy choices. How can we help make Crow Wing County accessible for people to be walking and biking and making those healthy choices? So we'll just kind of touch on some of those today. So this is our mission statement here: to improve the health and wellness of Crow Wing County residents by engaging formal and informal community leaders so that the healthy choice becomes the easy choice. So again, just that's what we want to do, make that healthy choice easier for everybody. Our guiding principles as a group is we seek to create and sustain a united approach to improving health and wellness in our community and surrounded area. So we're looking for those partners, whether it's in the workplace or whether it's with different groups, cyclist groups, all those sorts of things. We collaborate together. We seek collaboration towards solutions with multiple stakeholders, so especially the schools. Those are a key stakeholder. Work sites, medical centers, these are the places to really harness that community engagement and commitment focused on improving community health. We get those places that people are going to every single day or even on a repeated basis throughout the year. Those are great places to be partners with. And we seek to prioritize evidence-based efforts around greatest community good that can be achieved through our available resources. So we know there's a lot of different hyped up articles that we see online every day. We're really looking for, you know, the evidence-based practices that have been proven, you know, that we can repeat these efforts, we can duplicate them and get more communities or get more partners involved in doing things that work. Our Healthy Choices Goal Group, our leaders are Mark Ostgarden, which I don't see here, and Joanna Collins over at the Brainerd Family YMCA. So this group is developing sustainable strategies that encourage the population of Crow Wing County to make healthy choices. So this group is looking to, you know, increase access to healthy food choices, increase those active living opportunities, and promote and support healthy environments. So my next slides will kind of go through some projects that we've been involved with either providing grant dollars or volunteering hours or, you know, through marketing efforts, all of those kind of collaboration things. It all helps pull it together and promote it for the community. One thing we did last year was we did this community-wide bike rack project, which you've probably seen some of these around town. They have the Crow Wing Energized logo on them. They were distributed throughout the city of Brainerd. The Brainerd Lakes Chamber, Cross Lake Chamber, Cross Lake put a number in. The Cuyuna Medical Center is working on putting them, more of them around the Crosby area. So again, just making it easier so that if people are biking downtown, if a business wants to put one of these in front of their place of business, they can certainly contact Crow Wing Energized and we can see if that's a possibility. So again, we're just supporting making it easier for people to, you know, take their bikes around. These are some of the local Healthy Choices initiatives that we've done recently. We have helped to support flexible seating options in the schools. We've done that through providing grant dollars for some different kind of seating that kids have to balance on. So if kids have an attention issue or just to engage their core more, they make these little, I think they're called Hoka stools or something, but they sit on them and they're kind of on a pedestal and they have to balance more to sit on them. And we've also put in some taller tables where the kids can actually stand at the table and some that are adjustable so they can sit or stand. We've helped with community gardens over at the Northland Arboretum. At the Port Group Home, they have some going in there at Point Way Church. So again, these are done through funding or through small grants to help them get started with those efforts. We supported the local city planner in writing enforcements of active living in the Brainerd City Transportation Plan. We've helped with those signs that you've seen around town to encourage walking. So those little blue signs that have, you know, this many point whatever to downtown Brainerd, that sort of thing. We've helped with putting those signs up. We have offered the healthy snack cart option at Garfield and Lowell Elementary Schools. So that's kind of like a second chance breakfast for those kids that didn't bring in a snack. That's an option for them. And they're currently working on a fundraiser right now to continue that project going forward. We do support efforts surrounding safe routes to school. And we help with writing equipment and policy changes to encourage kids to be active. This recognizes Kids Camp in Crosby. We've also helped with supporting active recess at Lowell and Garfield Elementary Schools. So these kids now can have recess before lunch so that they burn off some energy, they eat better, and those games are also structured so that those kids are getting a little bit more social interaction as well. So it's just increasing how much time they're being active, and then they're coming in and they're being better eaters because everybody's hungry after they've just played. We've supported farm-to-school efforts in all public schools, so trying to connect with places like the farm at St. Matthias to get some of their fresh produce into the schools, and the school garden at Discovery Woods Montessori School. Our most recent project, which is still in the works, is a kids' bike fleet. And we just recently had the press release at Garfield School back on March 28th. And so because Crow Wing County or Crow Wing Energized, we were invited to apply for a grant because we received SHIP funds to apply for a grant from the Minnesota Super Bowl Legacy Fund to promote kids' activity. And so we wrote a grant to create two different bike fleets for the Brainerd area, or not Brainerd area, Crow Wing County as a whole. So we're actually having two bike fleets created. One of them has 40 bikes. 38 of those are kids' bikes geared towards that third and fourth grade age group. And then there's two adult bikes for the leaders of whatever field trip they go on. And then the small fleet has 20 bikes. 18 of those are kids, two again for the adult leaders. And there's two separate enclosed trailers. All of the safety equipment is in them, the spare parts, the supplies. There's a 5-year service contract for those bikes and, you know, anything that needs to be done with them. And those bikes, those fleets are going to be available to all elementary schools in Crow Wing County for free during the school year. And they can check them out for about a week at a time. And during that week, they can cover the Walk Bike Fun curriculum, which is the curriculum that's developed by the state to encourage bike safety for that age group. And so they can use those bikes for hands-on training. They can do a little maintenance stuff. They can do a little field trip with them. And then during the summer, they will be available on a checkout basis for a small fee. And it'll just be to youth-serving organizations, so things like the YMCA, the Community Ed, Kinship Partners, Girl Scouts, Boy Scouts, those youth serving groups, you know, that are working with that age group to, you know, go for a fun bike ride from the Arb up to Nisswa and have some ice cream and ride back, or, you know, whatever the case may be, we'll work with those organizations this summer to get those kids on those bikes. And that small amount that we charge for that rental will go into a maintenance fund, since it's all grant dollars that were used to purchase this equipment. We need some sustainability funds. So we're really excited for that project. I think it's going to get a lot of kids excited about being active, because even when Garfield School does their bike ride coming up in a few weeks from Brainerd to Nisswa, sometimes it's those kids' first time on a bike, you know, at that age group. So if we can give them a bike to use for a week and they can get excited about actually getting on one and, you know, understanding that they can balance and build that confidence that they can do that, hopefully we'll see some more kids out there being active and asking their parents for a bike. All right. Next. Oh.
Good afternoon, Todd Holman. You saw in the opening slide that I serve on the Baxter City Council, but I'm actually not representing the city or the city council in this venue, but I am a voice there, and I am a member of the No Name Bicycle Group. Oh, I need to be more here, sorry. The No Name Bicycle Group is an interesting name in that it intentionally didn't want to be that group of people, did not want to be necessarily affiliated or put in a box as a city committee or a commission. They really wanted to be an autonomous kind of bike-focused, connectivity-focused in their mission. The person who should be up here speaking tonight is Ray Griffin, or this afternoon, and Ray is actually the leader of the No Name Bike Group. He's traveling on his way back, so I'm a pinch hitter for the group. Ray and I started talking about the group about 5 years ago, and there were a couple of missions. Ray had a vision of trying to connect Crow Wing County, the whole county, north and south and east and west, with mapped bike routes that had good paved shoulders that people could ride on and feel safe. And so that was a big vision. I started visiting with Ray about being interested in the cities of Brainerd and Baxter and having east-west connections through Brainerd and Baxter and north-south connections, kind of paralleling the highway corridors, 371, 210, creating safe ways to route cyclists so that they weren't in conflict with some of the busiest, most choked and high traffic parts of the transportation system. So the two of us met and said, well, how do we start thinking about putting this in paper, putting this in practice? Both Ray and I are members of the Paul Bunyan Cyclists, too, which happens to be a group that Sharon is a member of, and they coordinate the Tour of Lakes event, but they have a lot of mapped routes. And so they ride once a week, every Wednesday night, and they ride different routes, usually hubbing out of the Paul Bunyan Trailhead at the Arboretum, but they ride routes all over the county. And so there was this depth of knowledge of where routes were, where they were safe, you know, and how to connect those to commuters. Like Eleanor was saying, some people ride to ride, others ride to get somewhere, go shopping, go to school, go to work. There are all kinds of different user groups, but the intent was to try to create a map or a route system that people could use and with some confidence know that if I live down here, how do I get to Cub Food, or how do I get to something over on the east side? You know, how do I do that? And there really wasn't a good space, or there wasn't a city map, there wasn't a website, there wasn't any one spot where you could go to look at that. And so we started this project with the idea of looking certainly at the Brainerd-Baxter area and seeing how we could stitch the pieces together. And so we reached out informally to people that rode bicycle and just started to ask them, where do you ride? And pretty soon we had a core group of about 8 to 12 people, and people would come in and out of the group. Some would move away, new people would come in. We've even had some city officials join in and out. We had a energized, growing energized person step into that group for a couple of meetings just to kind of listen and learn as to, you know, what are you doing and how are you making this move forward? So this map actually came out of it. Where do you ride, where do you feel safe, and where are the connections? And so the yellow was kind of the where people are riding and where we would like to ride with paved shoulders, where there would be places where we could do better. And guess what? Many different road authorities. Some of these were state roads, some of these were county roads, some of these are Brainerd roads, some of these are Baxter roads, some of them were probably township roads, unorganized territory roads. And so all of a sudden, you've got a matrix of road authorities that weren't necessarily stitching the bike connectivity piece together. They have other important jobs that they do, but the bike connectivity probably wasn't front and center. So this was a group of people wanting to kind of move or advance that connectivity at this kind of a scale. And you couldn't just start with a map, but this map was actually created by one of our city partners in the city of Baxter, I think, did this one. But we've had tons of support from both Brainerd and Baxter that if this group came in, and remember, it's not a group with a name or a city affiliation, but we would come to people like Mark, people like Josh, and ask, can we make a map like this? And sure enough, you know, a few days later, we'd have a wonderful map to kind of show and tell. The map allowed us to do this. I don't want you to read that, but this is the wonky type of people we are. So we broke this map into pieces because now that we knew where we wanted to connect and where to go, we had to break this into pieces to identify what needed in the bike community, in the bike riders' minds, what were things, amenities or types of design on the road that were helpful. And so we broke the roads into Brainerd Road sections and Baxter Road sections. And we looked at things, maybe the most important thing on this slide is the titles. The road name, where it began and ended, the type of pavement condition. How's that for descriptive? Good, poor, yeah. Remember, these are not engineers. These are bike ride folks that are just out there enjoying it. Now, since this started 5 or more years ago, the city of Baxter and probably the city of Brainerd too have an actual rating system. They put numbers on the types of road, what the condition of the road is, number of cracks, and they have a pretty sophisticated way of putting a score. So if we were to do this now, there'd be fives and fours and threes in there based on what the city was determining the road condition was. At any rate, so that was road condition. What's the shoulder? Does it have a paved shoulder or not? And the road I'll hold up as an example in Baxter, I know the best. If you're familiar with Highway 210 east-west through Baxter, there's a frontage road called Fairview on the north side of 210. Fairview Road was a paved road, older paved road, but it had a stripe in the middle and the fog lines, the white stripe on the side, and no paved shoulders. And yet, here it was, a corridor that went all the way from the west side of Baxter all the way to Englewood, and people were walking it, biking it, pushing strollers on it, and here there was no space. You know, really no, it wasn't safe, but because it connected, people were out there anyway, and we were convinced that more people would do that. They would walk if it felt safer and if it was easier, as Jessica pointed out. And so that road would have said no shoulder. It's probably on here. No shoulder. And then connects to other bike routes. Does it connect to other corridors that have paved shoulders or like the Paul Bunyan Trail or city trails that exist out there? So this was an assessment, and we wanted to bring this to the Baxter City Hall and to the Brainerd City Hall and say, does this make sense to you? Is this what your city wants to do? Can we use this so that when you get around to fixing the road, when the road's turn comes up, can we maybe look at adding shoulders? Can we look at adding a safety feature to that road? Because we've identified it as a riding community that's an important place. Not everywhere. If you remember the map, looks like a lot of yellow up there, but look at all the other roads that, you know, we really were looking at the routes people use to get to work, to get to school, to get from north to south. So we thought, well, what do we do with this next? We needed to talk to the people that knew these things, the city engineers and the county engineers. They're the ones that control what gets done on the roads. Wasn't us. And so Ray, I don't know, sent emails to everybody. And we didn't expect that the engineering staff would take the time to do that, but they did. They were quick to say, yeah, we'll meet. I think we met at Mark's shop over at the Brainerd City Hall, and we had county engineering staff, two cities engineering staff, and I think we even had a MnDOT person there. But it was evidence that there's interest from the engineering community. It's not adversarial, I guess is my point. And they knew that we were looking hard and that we could spell out what it is we were after. And what we learned was, from the engineering staff of all those government road authorities, was that if you can tell us these things, not when the paver is out there, but tell us 5 years in advance, we can actually do something. We can incorporate these types of goals, safety goals, connectivity goals, getting from A to B goals, into our capital plan 5 and 10 years in advance. And so once we knew or learned that engineering is really thinking 5 and 10 years out, well, we aren't gonna look at what they're doing next year. We're looking in their time scale. And they weren't opposed at all. As a matter of fact, they did, in the case of Baxter, which I knew the best, they did incorporate those paved shoulders into the planning so that it could be built. Now, it took a lot of discussion. I'm not going to downplay how much discussion it all takes in city process, county process. But nonetheless, they were quick to embrace it if there was enough lead time. And where things had gone wrong in the past was, I would say all modes, pedestrian, bicycle, and other, bumped into asking for changes when the design was done. You know, when the design is done, it's approved, the numbers are known, it's in the queue for funding. That's not the time to ask for a change. That's really the most difficult time to ask for a change. The time to ask for incorporation is 5 and 10 years in advance. So that was really the mission of the No Name Bike Group, went from identifying priorities for connectivity to injecting those priorities into local road authority planning structures in their time. Not to cater to the No Name Bike Group, but to fit into when local plans were being developed so that it was not adversarial, it was more part of, can we consider this at the time? And can we benefit? And sure enough, that's what happened. Engineering staff from both cities, Brainerd, Baxter, and probably, and I know the county partners as well, started to grab these plans and build other, I'm thinking about the aprons, and they would change signal pedestrian button controls and things, because if they were doing all of this at the same time, it made sense. And so I think it drew its own energy in terms of implementation. And so we see this certainly all over Baxter, all over Brainerd, because we're getting these pieces in early and often and getting people engaged. And that grassroots group, I tease about it, the no-name group, but it's really us. You know, it's people like all of us that just sit down and take the time to bring it to attention. And so what does it look like when that works? So we've been at this over 5 years now and had great success talking to local road authorities and planning. And after a period of time, this is the Baxter story because I know this one again. Over a period of time, we've created connections to the Paul Bunyan State Trail. We've done a trail system within Baxter, which is off the road, sometimes in the road right of way, but off the street. But we've also made an effort to connect this blue line on 210 is the Fairview Road. Inglewood is the blue line all the way up to 77, the Pine Beach Road. And you can see that if you connect paved shoulders to trails, that all of a sudden the system starts to work. You can actually get on this system and bike, push your stroller, walk, say rollerblade, I heard somebody say, Josh. You can rollerblade with some safety, and people will if they feel safe about it. And we've seen evidence, it's anecdotal because I don't think we have numbers in Baxter of users, but we see anecdotally just a real uptick in user groups. And it's not just Paul Bunyan cyclists, you know, these road rider people. It's moms and dads, it's people recovering from hip surgery, it's all manner of users that are out on these trails and paved shoulders because they connect and they go somewhere meaningful, sometimes to work, sometimes to school. In my neighborhood, I live here in this area, and I see all kinds of kids in the morning with these big backpacks on their backs, and they're biking down to Forest View Middle School right over here because there's a trail here and they can get there safely, and the parents know that they can get home and back safely. And so when it make it that way, people will in fact use it. I even heard at one point anecdotally that there was a problem at Forest View Middle School that they didn't have enough bike rack space. You know, when the weather's nice, maybe even more people ride than they have bike slots for. But, so Brainerd and Baxter was a focus. Crow Wing County North and South was a focus. But look what else got connected. The state, Paul Bunyan State Trail was built and ultimately ended up down to the state park. And now that park, and Robert would speak to this better than anybody, that probably didn't have a lot of bicycle traffic before that trail, incidental I would probably say. Now, every night, if I ride down there 2 or 3 nights, I'll meet 8 or 9 bikes going up and down there. So I think the day use group using the Crow Wing State Park facility, which is our facility, has probably gone way up. I don't know if there are numbers or people are tracking it, but you're riding along the Mississippi River in a state park, it's amazing. So there's functional, utilitarian, there's recreational, and it's all connecting together. And I'm smiling because it's taken many years for it to kind of connect that way. But that's the picture of our story. And I think it's your turn.
Okay. So I have been on the City of Greenwood Walkable Bikeable City Committee since 2013.
Oh, sorry.
Oops.
Thank you. We have 9 members on our committee, and we work closely with the City Council and the staff members, including Mark Osgarten and the city engineers. We also work closely, as Todd said, you know, we work closely with the MnDOT and Crow Wing County Transportation Department, because like he was mentioning, that these, we have the state highways and the county and different roads in the city, so we need to be working with them. We've been meeting monthly, and our meetings are open to the public. People are welcome to come, and we usually meet the 4th Monday of the month. So that's just a little bit about the group. So what we did is we developed a non-motorized transportation plan, which was developed. It took us a long time to develop it because we did surveys and audits and really thought about and looked at some of the different streets and where what's happening in the city of Brainerd and what needs to happen to make our city more walkable and bikeable. So the City Council had wanted us to do that, and we were looking at the strategic focus, and to develop walkable and bikeable neighborhoods was our primary goal. And then we needed to develop a comprehensive city-wide sidewalk, trail, and bike lane plans that is now included in the city comprehensive plan. And then it also is used as part of the Complete Streets program. And the plans are based upon the citizen involvement and input. We did a survey, I think it was 2 years ago now, of the city citizens of Brainerd and got input from them. And we did look at what are the barriers, and safety was one of them, of being a barrier, and to make so that we can look at being more safe. And then we've also looked at the exploration of developing a skate park for youth as part of our committee's goals or tasks. So when we were working on this, we actually got out and walked, and many of us bike ride anyway, but we walked, and even just like from where we live, you know, what did we see were the problems when we talked to other people? What were the things that were needed? And I don't know, so this is 13th Street as an example, and it was one of the streets that you had highlighted in yellow, and all the way from Washington Street, which is just a block over that, or 2 blocks, I guess, over north of us, all the way down to DC Road. And, you know, our goal someday is to have a separate trail. So not just a bike lane or whatever, but also to have a separate trail. This goes near the fairgrounds. It intersects with other cross streets that are used a lot for biking. So it's a place that makes sense to have a safe trail. One of the things that came up and that we're talking about is people walk and bike where it's convenient. And so where there is a lot of traffic, it makes sense to add more accessibility, because one person said, well, why don't you put it a couple blocks over so that it's not in the heart of everything? Well, people are not gonna walk 2 blocks out of their way just to walk on a trail. They're gonna walk where it's the fastest, especially if they're carrying groceries or whatever. So people want things to be convenient. And it's not any different for people who are walking or biking than people who are in a car. So those are some of the things we considered. In Brainerd, we have some dead-end sidewalks. I just love this. So it kind of just stops there, and we wanna make, particularly on some streets that we want to have connectivity throughout the city, that to make sure that these things actually connect with so that people can continue on walking. And part of that is working with the safe routes to school as well. Here's another one on H Street and Mill Avenue.
and which we all know is a very busy street, and we need some places to get across so people can get across the streets, and we're looking at doing some improvements there with traffic warning devices and some more crossings. So those are some walking things. And then here, this is one over by Walgreens. And that's one of the cities, one of the areas that's very busy in the city of Brainerd. And we want to, and it's also Riverside School is over in that area. There's a HUD housing over in that area. So there's a lot of different people using that. And Walgreens is right here. And it's a very busy, I mean, they sell groceries and all kinds of things, of course. So again, we're trying to look at what needs to happen, and probably a trail through here all the way down to College Avenue is what a goal could be, so that it's safe for people to both walk and bike to school, to get groceries, or whatever their business is. We've got, I've noticed before, wheelchairs, people with non-motorized motorized wheelchairs. So that's one kind of exception we look at as far as being non-motorized. That's one thing that we've talked about is there's people out there in wheelchairs that, you know, we want things to be safe for them as well. And those were just a few examples of it. So we did, in part of the non-motorized transportation plan, we had an overview. And from that, we had 10 goals and strategies for planned implementation. We had 46 different methods to implement and promote the plan that we're providing. So a lot of it is we're looking at infrastructure, and our recommendations are for a three-tiered plan over a period of 10 years. Oops. And this was approved in December of 2016. So at this point, we just met with the Safety and Public Works Department, and we're looking at getting these things to be talked about on the agenda so that, like when Todd said too, that when things are being planned in the future and developments or improvements are happening, that these things will be looked at as far as what the recommendations were in the plan. And we've received really good responses to the non-motorized transportation plan from the city council. And part of it is because we work so hard in working with the city engineers, the city planner, and MnDOT and the county as well before we even put this together. So it's not just a wish list in the sky. And again, it's not meant to be controversial or negative. It's meant, how can we improve this, our city, and make it more safe and walkable and bikeable? The full plan's available on the City of Brainerd website. And you don't even need to go to this long link here. You can just go to the City of Brainerd website, and then there'll be a link to the Walkable Bikeable City Committee, and the plan is in that box. So I'm going to turn it back to Todd to talk about area opportunities, I guess we all can talk about that too, but here's some of the area opportunities in the here, and here's another one to include, please. Mm-hmm. Oh.
One of the things that I forgot to mention with that ad hoc or no-name bike group, there are no fees, it doesn't cost anything. You know, we just go out, eat together, and organically look at these maps, make lists. But we really do strategically, as Eleanor indicated, go visit with the city officials to learn, you know, what's in the five-year plan. And then we bring, in Brainerd's case, with your committee, you actually have a formalized plan. We don't quite have that yet in the city of Baxter, but this group tries to track those projects and work with the county, the city, maybe even MnDOT if it's applicable, to try to get those priorities at least into the discussion group at least 5 years before the construction. So it's an ongoing effort, and that's some of the work that group does. Some of the local opportunities, Cuyuna Trails, that, by the way, is, for those that don't know it, the state legislature approved the Cuyuna State Trail designation that goes all the way from downtown Brainerd all the way to the city of Aiken. And there's been a lot of talk and construction and work done in the Cuyuna-Crosby area related to the Cuyuna Rec area, and a lot of work in the city of Brainerd connecting those dots is part of that legislation. It's work yet to be done, and so that's part of that opportunity, and a lot of people don't know it goes all the way to Aiken, so if that ever gets developed, you know, that's a real significant opportunity. But walking, cycling, mountain biking, and again, that points out how many different types of user groups there are. I talked about road riders, commuters, but this mountain bike group is a growing, really growing, and then there's another group out there called gravel riders, and that's another type of use group that takes a lot of road. So there are a lot of user groups out there. Paul Bunyan State Trail, or Paul Bunyan Trails, walking and biking, I mentioned the link to the Crow Wing State Park was really significant for our region, but that trail goes all the way to Bemidji, and so you can ride off-road all the way from Crow Wing State Park to north of Lake Bemidji to the Bemidji State Park, and that's an amazing state facility. And just to put in a plug, there's all kinds of angst at the legislature every year to decide where money goes, and funding state parks and state trails is an important part, because if it doesn't happen, trails are just like roads. They degrade over time. They need constant crack filling and maintenance and sometimes refurbishing. North and Arboretum, that's brand new. The addition of the exercise circle, I don't have the right word for it, maybe you guys know.
Fitness trail,
there we go. And I think there's something akin to that at the St. Matthias Park as well. Am I right there?
That's correct. It's not a fitness trail, but if you can do it, you probably be fit.
Gotta be fit, yeah.
So there's about a 60-foot drop from the parking lot to the river over 6/10 of a mile, or the circuit is a mile or 2/10, so about 2 kilometers. But it has a natural feature, which I think is really a plus for this area. And for those people who don't see areas with trees that I cannot be surrounding, you probably can't either. More than just a few are out there because somebody left those during the last century.
It's an amazing facility, and there's no fee, right?
You can
just park.
Downtown St. Matthias?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Downtown St. Matthias. Across from the Catholic Church.
Park by the ball field there, kind of a, yeah.
And if I can say, we are having an open house next Saturday, the 29th, from 9 to 11 in the morning. However, I tell people, don't wait, but the paddock are blooming, and I see much more. And just this morning, the water is really going into the room.
And that's a labor of love on your shoulders and a few hardy volunteers that do all of that work at the St. Matthias Park. But that trail takes you all the way down to the Nokasippi River, and it's just a spectacular. If you've not been there, it's just a little bit off east of 371, but it's a little piece of wonderful natural area.
Or continue south on St. Matthias Road, past St. Matthias, about 5 miles. You'll see the green sign.
The Brainerd High School, Crosby, these mountain bike teams are an up-and-coming, growing. These are competitive, statewide competitive. We happen to have, with the Cuyuna State Rec Area, probably the premier facility for people to ride in. So the kids that are in our community that are participating really are training and riding in one of the best facilities probably in the country. Numerous areas of walking and rides for causes. You'll see that all of the time. The Paul Bunyan Cyclists has Wednesday night rides. There are other groups that have other night rides that are less formal, but the Paul Bunyan Cyclists, and Sharon, because I've been a poor attendee, my perception and what I hear is that the numbers of people that come to ride on Wednesday have grown and grown. And it used to be a handful, and now there are so many that I think you have to divide up into groups by maybe rider ability. There are the 20-mile-an-hour people, and then there's me way back here a ways. So I think the Paul Bunyan Cyclists work to train or teach really safe road riding and working within kind of the ability levels of people that come. And that's Wednesday. The Tour of Lakes is an annual event that the Paul Bunyan Cyclists have put on for how many years?
28th annual this year.
28th annual. Yeah, and it's staged out of Cross Lake this year, correct?
Sure.
Yeah. Moves about the plane, but it always...
Online by May 5th.
So coming up quick.
Go to our website and then it'll connect you.
One of the things that I neglected to mention during that map discussion, that the yellow road map, is that map intentionally connects to the local Brainerd Crow Wing transit system too. The shuttle buses that you see moving about the community are part of the Dial-A-Ride system, but they also have a fixed route that they operate on during the day. Some of us are working on trying to get the fixed route expanded so it starts earlier, runs later, and can be a true cog in the commuter network of functionality. But at all costs, you know, everybody is a part of that system, has opportunity to use it.
Those vans have bike racks?
All of those shuttles have bike racks.
And I picked up some brochures on that, and they're still in my office, but I'll run and get them as soon as we're done with the presentation. So there's actually brochures on using the system. So you can bike to work, and then you could get a ride home on the bus. But you do need to dial a ride, so you do need to arrange it.
The transit office is down in the basement of Brainerd City Hall, or you can get these tickets up at the land use planning office in Brainerd. So you can buy $10 worth of ride tickets on it. My whole point in bringing it up was to bring about awareness to that system, but also the fact that you have the rack on there. And so let's say you don't want to get sweaty and ride to work, you can ride the shuttle to work, and then you can be sweaty on the way home. So it can work. Some of us have jobs where you move around to lots of meetings and maybe it doesn't work. But for those that it does, and on the days that it does, that's the way I use it. But you can mix and match. You can put part bike, part transit, but it's all part of the greater good system. It just needs, in my opinion, to be expanded. And the route needs to be maybe tailored to get to some places where it isn't currently today. So those are just works in progress that probably go across Mark's desk, and there are people from Crow Wing County on it as well. Discussion, and this is the place where I think we wanted to hear from you. What's that?
Oh, it quit showing it after I...
Did I blow it?
No, I blew it.
We wanted to kind of, you've seen what we had to share. We're interested in your feedback, good idea, bad idea, if you just do this instead of that. We'd like to hear some of those thoughts and comments from all of you as well. Yes, sir.
Application of some of the ideas that you have said that you have been considering. The situation that comes into my mind is the planning that's being done for that roundabout just south of Culver.
Mm.
And the potential for the expansion of businesses south of that, where the roundabout supposedly is going to go. Any discussion as to how it's going to be easy for a pedestrian or a bicyclist to get from Calp area to the area south of the roundabout or future roundabout?
Great question. I wish I had an illustration of that up here because it's hard to visualize or explain that without a good graphic. But right now, I would even argue that if you wanted to go from Cub to the liquor store, which is right across the corner to complete your shopping afternoon, even that is dangerous because in Baxter we don't have pedestrian crossings or walkways. And so that's how it exists today. The roundabout construction is one of those facilities that really brings pedestrian safety to the forefront. And so where the roundabout is, there will be four pedestrian crosswalks. And so pedestrians will know that they don't have to run and dodge and dash. You still have to be mindful, but there are four in a roundabout. There are four streets, and so four places to cross that are marked. Traffic signs that come to it are marked to bring awareness to pedestrians and bike riders. There will be, in some cases, paved